Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh to all the brothers and sisters that are here.
Wa alaikum
salam. My name is Sayyid Raza Rizvi. I'm here representing Al Bayt Al Ghadir. It's our movement and it's to promote awareness of the Shia sect and part of the Islamic religion. So we're here today outside the Saudi embassy. So this is the first time I've come here, and alhamdulillah I can see there's quite a couple of brothers here. But what I see straight away is that it's all from one community. Now, say, my elder and respected Sayyid Hassan Bukhari, he mentioned the cultural, historic aspect of importance of preserving your monuments and how important that is for every community. Indeed, it is upon the fitrah, meaning it's a human nature to preserve your heritage. It's not nothing to do with religion or sects. It's something that everyone does, regardless of their religion. So Hassan Bukhari spoke about it from a perspective of humanity. I'm going to get a bit technical and speak about it from a textual point of view, because no doubt every leader of their respective religion has always spent time preserving their heritage, whether it's the Jewish community, whether it's the Christian community, or any other religion. Even in the Indo-Pak, we preserve. The other day, where was we? We was outside near Buckinghamshire, outside the Queen's Palace, if I'm not mistaken. Even the English people, they preserve their heritage, because they realize that is what they're about. If you don't have no heritage, where did you come from? Who are you? So in the same way, Islam recognizes to preserve heritage, and it recognizes that. Now, the first aspect of it is that what we do in regards to this heritage is basically what we do is we visit them. So what happened in Jannat al-Baqi, Al-Jannat al-Baqi is a graveyard in Medina al-Munawwara. That graveyard is, as they say, al-Baqi, it's like a garden. And over time, the Prophet was the first person to actually bury one of his companions there. Uthman ibn Madhun, if I'm not mistaken. After that, people, all the believers, wanting to follow the Prophet, started burying their loved ones there. Eventually what happened was, it got bigger and bigger, and it became an amazing blessed place of all the respected personalities. And all Muslims have someone who they love and revere who is buried in that thing. Whether it's for us, it's the Ahlul Bayt, or whether it's for the Sunni community, certain Sahaba. The point here is that those shrines were built by those companions, by the people historically. And sometimes you can get to textual proof, but one thing that's important is you also have to look at it from the perspective of history. Let me give you an example. If historically something's been there, I'll give you an example. There's a building, I'm not going to give the Saudi embassy any importance, but let's say there's a building behind me. This building, imagine it's been here for 1,000 years. And for 1,000 years, no matter what government who's ruled this country has not demolished it. What does that tell you? It tells you that there was some sort of importance to this. No matter what empire you were from, no one wanted to destroy it. It was nothing to do with sectarianism. No one destroyed it. Now, if someone then produces a text and says, oh, all shrines should be destroyed, straight away you can say practically that tradition is dismissed. Because you can tell by the people not acting upon it, that's proof in itself that's dismissed. No one took it seriously. In the same way, our heritage has been there for 1,000 years. Even the tyrants that used to rule, they never had the audacity to try and destroy these shrines. If I'm not mistaken, Mutawakkil from the Abbasi, only these people used to destroy the Prophet's family shrine.
But didn't base it on text.
Exactly, that's key. They based it on their hate of the Prophet's family and their hate of the Prophet. Today what you have is intellectual dishonesty. When people in front of us, the Saudi embassy and their people and the government and what they represent, when they destroy it, because they know no one will accept it, they run behind texts and they try and distort it. It's ironic that, one of my brothers just mentioned to me, it's ironic that look, behind us, we have a building with faces on it. Ironically, according to this embassy and according to their movement, those faces should be destroyed. How ironic that right opposite them, they've got faces. So the point here is that these people have been doing this for years. And what's important to know is that before they rule, this is key, and this is what I will urge. And again, this is nothing to do with sectarianism. I would urge the people, the majority of the Muslim world is not Shia. The majority of the Muslim world is Sunnis. And it's time to wake up. Because guess what? Outside here today, we've got all Shias here. Where's all the other communities? Why are we defending the heritage? Is Jannat al-Baqi only for the Shias? Is there no loved ones of the Sunnis there? So from day that we're having to back people and they're not coming, it's showing that the Saudi people, when they took over, the Ottomans ruled before Saudi Arabia. The Ottomans ruled before Saudi Arabia. They did not demolish any shrine in Saudi, in Jannat al-Baqi. They built them and they respected it. And they honored it. For years, only when the Saudi took takeover of, because even the word Saudi Arabia is actually, I'm only saying it orphan, meaning because it's common usage. That land is Arabia. That land from the Prophet's time, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, till now is Arabia. No one had the audacity in terms of king, governor, whether it be the Umayyad or the Abbasi or even the Ottoman, had the audacity to rename that land, rename it in their own family heritage. So imagine that when the tribe of Al Saud took over about 150, 200 years ago, when they took over, they renamed the whole land. The sheer audacity that they were able to do this just shows the state that we're in, that they were able to do this. And when they took over, this is very key because this links to our narrative. When they took over, they destroyed Jannat al-Baqi, they destroyed all the shrines, they destroyed the shrines of the Prophet's family. We are Shia. Four of our imams are the Imam al-Hassan alayhi salam, Imam al-Zayn al-Abidin alayhi salam, Imam Muhammad Baqir alayhi salam, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam, alayhi salam, salamullah alayhi. All of these people were buried there with shrines. The Ottomans preserved it because Ottomans and the Sunnis loved them as well. They're not only Shia figures, we all love them. So what happened is when they destroyed it, the Saudis, they destroyed them, they destroyed the companions. And they didn't just destroy shrines, they destroyed heritage, houses. Houses that have been there for thousands of years. Let this movement carry on within 100 years. Let the community keep sleeping. Within 100 years, when you say I'm Muslim, they'll say, so where's your proof the Prophet even existed? You won't even have nothing but textbook. You won't even, because the Prophet's 1,000 years. No religion has someone who's come so recent. All other religions are ancient. They have to struggle to find something that relates to them. Our heritage is 1,400 years ago. So we've got lots of stuff there. And what do we see? In Iraq, they've done the same thing. As soon as that kind of mentality took over, and again, I'm not even here to talk about that subject, but I'm saying the mentality. They destroyed the shrines in Iraq as well, and that's what they wanted to do for a long time.
Libya,
same thing. All of the same thing. And they've been doing this for a couple of years now. Now, one thing that I want to see, and after that, inshallah, I'm going to get to the traditions, and inshallah, we'll end at that, is that the irony is that they say it's because of religion. Remember, I told you it's an excuse. Religious text is an excuse because guess what? You're a new sect. For 1400 years, no school, no Islamic school has had this concept that you have to destroy shrines. It's just a historical truth that we have to accept. When it comes down to their own people, the graves, the people who was the monument, the standard bearer of this movement, people like Ibn Taymiyyah, etc., etc., these kind of people, all their shrines are mehfuz. All their shrines are protected and they have shrines. So if you were consistent, why are their shrines not dropped? Oh, so hold on, let me guess. The shrines are only dropped if it's the Ahlul Bayt. Okay, so the text only applies there then. Because Ibn Taymiyyah's shrine is fine. That's in terms of the movement. Let me go to the Sunni community. Imam Abu Hanifa, Indo-Pak, we're from the Indo-Pak, we know Abu Hanifa well. Imam Abu Hanifa, Baghdad, his shrine is perfectly preserved. Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani, who the Sunnis and Salafis preserve, who they all rate, his shrine is preserved. So the shrines are all preserved for these movements. It's only when it comes down to our movement and our people that then they do this. I think Sayyid mentioned Muawiyah as well, in Syria, preserved. So it's all preserved. It's only when it comes down to it that Ahlul Bayt, the Prophet's family, and the people of Baqi. And the thing is, they haven't even differentiated between Sunnis because they see people that Sunnis love, their Khulafa, even their ones have been destroyed. So it's about time the Ummah wakes up and starts mentioning these crimes. And again, I don't want to go in the political wing, but we live in this country. We get told to be against extremism. And we don't need to be told that because we are anyway. It's part of religion to be against extremism. But hold on, you can't keep saying be against extremism and then be cool with Saudi. How does that work? So the point is that you need to be consistent in your message. If you're going to be extremism, be against extremism, be consistent in your message. And say wrong is wrong no matter where it is. Now, based on that now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to a couple of traditions in regards to visiting the graves. So first of all, I'm going to talk about the Prophet and how he mentioned about visiting graves. Then I'm going to speak about specifically the Prophet saying, mentioning himself and how important it is. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I have prohibited you from ziyarah of graves. Ziyarah means visitation. Ziyarah of graves. From now on, go for ziyarah because this will make you feel unattached towards this world and make you remember the hereafter. Meaning the concept of visiting shrines is to remember those who have passed before you, no matter how great they were, so you can learn from them. Because one day you will go to the same place. People a lot greater than us have gone to the graves, so you will go one day as well. Second tradition, the Holy Prophet visited the graves of his mother, Sayyidah Amina, salamullah alayha, and who these people, by the way, don't regard as Muslim, and cried near her grave, also made others him to cry. Therefore he said, I have taken permission from my Lord to visit the grave of my mother. You too should visit the graves because such a visit will remind you of my death. I've been cut short because of Brother Allah. There's a lot of people here, so I don't want to take up the mic too much. I think I already have, so I'm sorry for that, brothers. But these two traditions to make you understand that Islamic, there's always been a concept to visit graves, and the Prophet and the Prophet's family have generally, and the whole Muslim world, if you look at any country, they've always had shrines and visitations, always been an important part of the Islamic theology and practical system. And I'll leave you with that. Salam be upon the Prophet and his family and to all the believers here. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Mashallah. Mashallah.
Terrorists!
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 Terrorists!